if you have an ideal op amp, then adding any voltage VA in series with the output of the op amp will do nothing to the potential at this node. Does it make sense? So it turns out that this simple results in a lot of interesting network properties. Before I get into that, I will show you a simple network principle. Let's say you have a linear network. For the time being, let's not consider op amps inside. Any linear network with controlled sources and so on. So there is an input voltage. All the ground terminals inside the network can be collected as one terminal, which is ground, and there is some output voltage. So I will call this network N. This is ground, and I measure my output with respect to ground. So I will just denote that by a voltmeter. Connected between ground and the output. If the gain of the network is H, then if I put in Vin at the input of the network, what will I get at the output? H times Vin. And the voltmeter will read obviously H times Vin. And we all understand that ground is simply a reference with respect to which we measure voltages. So to make things explicit, I will make Vin this way. If I now lift this node off ground and make this some arbitrary value Vx, what will happen to the voltmeter reading? Nothing will happen. We all agree on that? Now, if I now connect the other lead of the voltmeter to this new ground, what will be the reading on the voltmeter? What was originally HVN will now read HVN plus VX. We are all experts at pushing voltage sources through. If I now push this VX through this node, what will happen? I can replace this by two voltage sources, one like this and another one like this. Does it make sense? And this goes to ground. Please note that all this is valid for any value of Vx. So I will choose Vx to be equal to minus Vin. So what happens if I make this minus Vin, if I make this also minus Vin? If this is Vin and this is minus Vin, I can combine these two voltage sources and that becomes a short circuit. Can see clearly that this is equivalent to connecting the original input to ground. So if I connect the original input to ground, the terminal which is grounded, if I connect it to minus Vin, the output voltage should still be, please note that Vx is equal to minus Vin. What the voltmeter will read will be H minus 1 times Vn. And this is a linear network. So instead of putting minus Vn, if I put plus Vn here, what will happen to the output? If I put plus Vn here, what I will get will be 1 minus H times V. let's just review what we have done. If I had a network N where the ground terminal represents all the grounds in the network, and there was one input with V in, and if the output was H times V in, then if I interchange input and ground, what do I get? 1 minus H times V in. If I interchange input and ground, the transfer functions will add up to 1. If I took a network, interchanged input with ground, found the transfer function in both cases and added them, the sum of the two transfer functions will be 1. Here I assume that H is constant, but H could be dependent on frequency. You will have H of X, but the entire derivation will remain identical. Examples, if this is R1 and R2, what is the transfer function from V in to V out? R2 by R1 plus R2. If I interchange input and ground, this is R1 times V in by R1 plus R2. And the transfer function here is R2 by R1 plus R2. And the transfer function here is R1 by R1 plus R2. And abracadabra, the sum is 1. You understand? So now let's see how this changes once you have ideal op amps inside the network. In a network, I could have many grounds. In the sense that, for example, like when I say only one ground terminal is coming out of the network, what I mean is all these things are connected together, and that is one single ground. Now, once you have networks with ideal op amps, things are not as straightforward anymore. Why? If you will recall, the ideal op amp is basically Rin is infinity, Rout is 0 and so on. This gain is infinite. But unfortunately, we do not have access to this ground. This is all we have access to. When there is an arbitrary network with linear elements, controlled sources and op amps inside, then it is not possible to come out with just one single terminal, which is ground. And listen, man, what is this? Sit down. In other words, when you have a network with linear elements and op amps, you can isolate all the accessible grounds as one terminal, all the unaccessible grounds. I know that I cannot access it, but nevertheless, it is there. The red is the one you cannot access. The black is the one you can access. You understand? So, this is a network with ideal op amps. So, now let's see where this leads us. So, if I had V in and the output was H times V in, I could do the same thing that I did before, put a voltmeter, you know, lift off the ground and all that. You are already familiar with the entire argument, so I am not going to go through it over it again. If I did this, what would this be? So this is exactly what we have done for the earlier case. So the only difficulty is that in practice, I will not be able to place Vn in series with these unaccessible grounds which are internal to the op amp. But if I was able to do so, then the output would be 1 minus H times Va. Is that clear? Let's look a little closely at these guys. What does this mean? If I took any op amp, it basically will mean that in series with the op amp output source, I should now put Vin. So in other words, what this is telling me is that if I inserted a voltage source of Vin in series with every op amp in the circuit like this, then the output of the network will be 1 minus H times Vin. Because all these unaccessible grounds are basically like the following. I mean, you have op amp 1, this goes to some part of the network, you have some other op amp 2, and all these are the unaccessible grounds. So op amp 1, op amp 2, and so on. All these are the unaccessible grounds. Which are all bought out through this terminal is this. And what we need to do is to put a voltage source Vn in series with this inaccessible ground, which is equivalent to pushing it through each of these nodes. And so on. And what did we just see? We saw that if we had an ideal op amp, adding a voltage source in series with the output does nothing. So whether you add these voltage sources in series or you don't, the outputs must remain the same. Is that clear? That if I simply interchange input and ground, in a linear network consisting of ideal op amps placed in negative feedback loops, then the transfer function will be 1 minus H times Vn. This was trivial to prove with a linear network without op amps. Magically, it turns out that when you have ideal op amps embedded in negative feedback loops, it is also true even though you have not actually applied this Vn to the hidden grounds in the op amps, and you have seen why it doesn't matter. This is a very important property of op amp circuits with negative feedback loops. In other words, if I add Vn, I will get H times Vn. If I interchange input and ground, I will get 1 minus H times Vn. In other words, transfer functions obtained by interchanging input and ground are complementary. If you add the two of them, you get 1. So to give you a simple example, as an illustration, Vn R K minus 1 into R. What is the transfer function? K times Vn. Now if I took the same thing, if I interchange input and ground, what should I do? I should replace this with Vn. Replace this with ground. V out in the first case was K times V in. V out in the second case is minus K minus 1 times V in. So H1 is K, H2 is 1 minus K, and viola H1 plus H2 is 1. It sounds like magic when somebody states the theorem, but it's quite straightforward to prove. But do you think it will still hold when the op amp is non-ideal? Real op amp, the gain is, you know, A by 1 plus S by omega D and all that. So do you think it will still hold? No. Why? It will not hold because V in divided by A must be 0. So when the gain starts to decrease, obviously that's no longer true. So it will not hold. However, this is a useful trick to generate a whole lot of circuit. Okay, so for example, you had some transfer function. You know how to realize it easily. If you wanted 1 minus the transfer function, there is no need to start all over again. You take what you have, interchange, input and ground, so you will get 1 minus H. So we have seen so far networks with resistors only. An amplifier with positive gain, amplifier with negative gain, positive summation, negative summation. The next thing is to start introducing reactive elements. So in analog signal processing, what do you do to signals? You integrate, you differentiate, and then once you have integrators and differentiators, you can combine them to implement any arbitrary differential equation. If you add an impedance Z1 and impedance Z2, this is Vi, this is Vo. What is Vo of S by Vi of S? Minus Z2 by Z1. Alright? So, an example of that is the following. So, when is this equation true? What conditions must be satisfied for the input to output to be minus Z2 by Z1? V out by V in will be equal to minus Z2 by Z1 as long as the op amp has got an infinite gain, or in practice a very very large gain. That's important to note because of the following. If for example did this, this is R and this is C. What is VO by VI? Minus 1 by SCR. I mean, and as I just pointed out, this is only true if the op amp has got very very large gain. So if I went to the lab and hooked up a circuit like this, what do you think will happen? Oh, so the answer is somebody said it will saturate. The question is why? Let me say V in was 0. If I connected it to ground, just like this guy here, what do you think will happen? If the capacitor has no charge, the output will be 0. Is that a fair statement? What is the quiescent voltage at the output of the op amp? For DC, it's as good as not having the capacitor. To determine the quiescent voltage at the output of the op amp, you will remove all capacitors. What is the quiescent value at the output of the op amp? ideally it is zero, but in practice what will it be? It will be 8 times whatever input voltage is there here, and it's impossible to get absolute zero between these two. So what will the output voltage be? It will almost always be either VCC or VE. In a practical op-amp, because of what is called device mismatch, in the differential pair we saw that if both the transistors Q1 and Q2 are exactly identical and you apply same potential to both their bases, then the tail current will split equally between both the transistors. In practice, both the transistors will not be the same. There will be a very, very tiny differences, which means that the current will not split equally between both the transistors, which is equivalent to saying that you have some kind of very, very small voltage internal to the op-amp. So this delta V is often called the offset, and this is due to device mismatch. So this is the true model for an op-amp, a practical op-amp, apart from this A0 divided by 1 plus S by omega D. So DC signals, what happens to the output? If I operate the op-amp as an integrator, what happens? The output will attempt to go to A times delta V, and since A is very, very large, A times delta V will always almost be equal, greater than or equal to VCC or less than minus VEE. The true characteristics of the op-amp are like this. So V plus minus V minus, and this is V out. As you have seen, there will be an upper limit to this, the output swing, and the lower limit. And because of the delta V, so this will be slightly smaller than VCC. This will be slightly larger than minus VEE. This represents the delta V, that's the offset. When the difference V plus minus V minus is zero, so that is V plus, this is V minus. When V plus and V minus are shorted together, what actually happens is that the true input to the op-amp is equivalent to delta V. It's just that this curve is shifted to the left. That's all. This is exaggerated. Okay, the A is very small here. In practice, what will happen is that this slope, if you plot X in microvolts, Y scale on volts, even then you will not be able to see this straight line. V out is in volts. This is to indicate that the slope is very, very, very high. Even if there is a small delta V of the order of a few microvolts, it's enough to cause the output of the op-amp become stuck either at the top most limit or the bottom most limit. So as I said before, you should never operate an op-amp in open loop for DC signals. As far as the integrator is concerned, we just discussed that the transfer function will be minus 1 over SCR only if this guy is behaving like a high gain amplifier. In practice, because of this delta V, okay, the offset of the op-amp, you will find that If I ground the input, the op-amp is basically sitting here. And what is the gain of the op-amp in that region? The gain is nothing but the slope of the characteristic. The gain of the op-amp is zero. This being minus 1 by SCR obviously will not happen. Well, I have talked about this only in the context of an op-amp. It is true of any system with a very, very large DC gain. So you should never operate a system with a large DC gain in open loop. However, if this guy here is a part of a negative feedback system, if this op-amp is sitting inside a larger negative feedback loop, then it is possible, and I'll show you examples of circuits where that happens. It is possible to make sure that the op-amp output quiescent value is sitting at zero, in which case this integration becomes possible. I will stop. We'll continue on.